Hello, dear students. I hope you all are safe and healthy at your home. My name is Ankita and I am teaching as an assistant professor in Department of Computer Science and Engineering at St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management, Gurugram. I welcome all of you to the online lecture series of System Analysis and Design, which is a subject of Bachelor's of Business Administration, Semester 6th. And this is our video lecture 4. So in this video, we are going to study about the ER data models, the various feasibility study in terms of economic, technical and the operational. And we will also revise some roles of system analyst importantly. So in previous video, we studied about who is system analyst, what are the roles of a system analyst and what are the characteristics of system analyst in terms of management and interpersonal skills. If you want to revise these topics again, you can refer my previous video lecture, that is lecture 3. So in this video, we will revise the role of system analyst. So system analyst is a person who is thoroughly aware of the system and guides the system development project also by giving the proper direction to its subordinates or to colleagues. So you can consider him as an expert who is having technical and the interpersonal skills to carry out the development task required on each phase. So its main roles are, first of all, to understand and define the requirements from the user, then prioritizing the requirements, then gathering the facts or the information and acquiring the opinions of users, and then maintain analysis and the evaluation of evaluation to arrive at an appropriate system which is more user friendly, suggest many flexible alternative solution also, and pick the best solution and quantify the cost and the benefits. He also sees the cost and the benefits associated with the best solution he is referring, and he also draws certain specification which are easily understood by the users and the programmer in the precise and the detailed form. He also responsible for implementing the logical design of the system, which must be modular. Okay, because modular programming or modular solution towards a problem is easy to understand. He also plan the periodicity for the evaluation after it has been used for some time and modify the system as needed. So these are the main roles a system analyst must perform while staying in any organization, while staying involved in some development of the project. So next is entity relationship model. So every project which we work on, that depends on some entities, and there are some entities also relate. So the next is entity relationship model. So in every project, there are some entities, and entities contain some attributes associated with it. Entity can be any real world object, like if we consider the example of library management system, then student is an entity in that. Okay, so in student in school database also, student, teachers, classes and courses, because they have certain properties like class names, student name, class strength. So these are the various properties associated with each entity. And the entity set is a collection of similar types of entity. When we have 10 or 50 students, then that is known as the entity set. An entity set may contain entities with attributes sharing similar values. For example, student may contain all the students of a school. Likewise, a teacher may contain all the teachers of a school. So next is the attributes. What are the attributes? Entities are represented by means of their properties, which are also known as attributes. Like if we have a student, then student name, student age, these are the properties or the attributes. All attributes have some values, like age will be having a number value, like 21, 22. For example, a student entity may have class, age and as the attribute. There exists a domain or range of the values that can be assigned to the attributes also. So you can assign a range also, or range of values to the attributes as well. Like you can consider an example of a class that wherein only the student of having age 30 can be, you know, admitted. So above the age of 30, the students cannot get admitted in that class. So that is the range you have specified. So within that range, we will be taking admission. So that may be the condition. For example, any student name cannot be numeric value. Yeah, that is again another example of attributes, assigning attributes. Like student name will not have numeric value. That will be a character value, obviously. Alphabetic. Okay, student and age cannot be negative. So if you specify some constants within the in terms of the range, then those attributes, you know, they are known as domain or the range of the values. They are having domain or the range of the values. So there are different types of attributes: simple attributes, composite attributes, derived attributes. So simple attributes are atomic values which cannot be divided further. For example, a student phone number can be an atomic value of 10 digits. Composite attribute says that they are made of more than one simple attribute. For example, a student's complete name have first name and the last name. So it is the combination of two different attributes. And derived means that the attributes that do not exist in the physical database, but their values are derived from the other attributes present in the database. For example, consider salary in a department. That should be saved directly in the database. Instead it can be derived. So like age can be derived from the date of birth. Okay, so the average salary can be derived from the department. Next is single value attribute that contains only one value, like your roll number or security number, for example. Multi-value attribute may contain more than one values. For example, a person can have more than one phone number, email addresses, etc. So these attribute types can come together in a way like simple single attribute, simple multi-valued attribute, composite single-valued attributes, and composite multi-valued attributes. So these all attributes can be type of attributes can be combined in this manner. Okay, next we move on to the entity set and keys. Key is an attribute or the collection of attributes that uniquely identifies an entity among the entity set. So key is a kind of attribute, or key in general term is very important thing that to by which you just open the lock to some door, or you get into that room. Without that key you cannot enter, or you cannot have access of that room. So in database or in system analysis and design also, key have some values, or you can say key is an attribute or the collection of attribute that uniquely identifies an entity, like a roll number. For example, if a student will have a roll number 1, then we can identify him that this roll number belongs to this class and this its name is this. So key attributes are those unique values with which we can identify some entity. For example, the roll number of a student. So there are some types of keys which are very important in while studying the database management system. Super key is a set of attributes that collectively identifies an entity in an entity set. And candidate is the minimal super key, is called the candidate key. An entity set may have more than one candidate key. So primary key contains, and the primary key is the most important most important key in DBMS. It is one of the candidate keys chosen by the database designer to uniquely identify the entity set. So next we will explain entity relationship, ER relationship, entity relationship diagram or model, you can say. So next is ER relationship. So this association among entities is called a relationship. So next is entity relationship model. So the association among entities is called the relationship among them. For example, an employee works at a department. A student enrolls in a course. So here works at and enrolls are the relationships. So relationship sets are further divided into different categories, we will see. And on the basis of those on which the relationships are divided. First of all, let us read what relationship set is. A set of relationships of similar type is called the relationship set. Like entity, a relationship too can have attributes. So these attributes are called descriptive attributes. So degree of relationship can be binary, ternary or n-ary. Okay, the number of participating entities in a relationship defines the degree of relationship. Binary is equal to degree 2, ternary degree 3 and n-ary is equal to the degree only. So n defines any number of the relationship. Mapping cardinalities, so these are the terms which are associated with the relationship of your entities. Cardinality defines the number of entities in one entity set which can be associated with the number of entities of another set via relationship set. So these cardinality depend upon four things: one to one, one to many, many to one, and many to many. So a one to one relationship says that one entity from entity set, for example, A can be associated with at most one entity of entity set B, and vice versa. Like here you can see these are the entities. If we want to explain, entity can be defined as that if we have some data base, or you can say some entity student, then student is the entity and its name, its age, these are the attributes of this entity. Similarly, teacher is an entity, and teacher name, subject teaching, these are the attributes of these entities. So teachers are the entities and these are the students. So A and B, these are the entity set. So further, it contains many entities. Like A can be considered as student, teacher, and so B can be considered as manager and an HR manager or your CRM manager. Okay, so how there is one to one communication or one to one connection between two entity set, that is known as one to one cardinality or one to one mapping cardinality. When one entity from A entity set is related to, is having relationship with the one entity in the B entity set, then it is known as one to one. One to many defines that one entity from entity set A can be associated with many, with more than one entities of entity set B. However, an entity from the B set can be associated with at most one entity. Okay, here these can be, so first, this entity can be associated with two, more than one of the entity set B. This can be to this, this can be to this. Okay, so okay, it is showing the bidirectional relationship. So what it is saying, that one entity from entity set A can be associated with more than one entity set or one entities of entity set B. This is connected with more than one entity set of B. However, the entities from the entity set B can be associated with at most one entity. See, relationship will be in this direction. This can have more this can have relationship with more than one entities, but from B entity set they will be connected to a single node or entity. Many to many relationship says more than one entity from a set A can be associated with at most one entity of so this is one to many, but this will be many to one. So these associated with from this to this also. Okay, I hope it is clear to you. Many to many relationship says one entity from A can be associated with more than one entity from B and vice versa. So this was the ER model, data model, through which we represent the relationship among the data, or data is known as the entity. Okay, so the values associated with that entity is known as the attribute. Next is the feasibility study. So we will see, feasibility study says that it is done at the requirement phase or requirement analysis phase in SDLC. So feasibility study says that it is a process to check whether we can achieve the specified requirements or not. So from in technical feasibility, the following issues are taken into consideration when we have to check the technical feasibility of the project. that whether the required technology is available or not, and whether the required resources are available or not. For example, manpower, programmers, testers, debuggers, software and hardware. So in terms of technical feasibility, all these things should be kept in mind. Once the technical feasibility is established, it is important to consider the mandatory factor also. Since it might happen that developing a particular system may be technically possible, but it may require huge investments and benefits may be less. Because we have to check the each and every technical aspect of the requirement, so it may include huge investments. And for evaluating this, economic feasibility of the proposed system is carried out. So for evaluating this, that how much investment we have to do in technical feasibility, we have to study the economic feasibility. For any system, if the expected benefits equal or exceed the expected cost, the system can be judged to be economically feasible. Okay, so this is very simple line. In economic feasibility, the cost benefits analysis is done, in which expected costs and benefits are evaluated. Economic analysis is used for evaluating effectiveness of the proposed system. In economic feasibility, the most important is cost benefit analysis. As the name suggests, it is an analysis of the costs to be incurred in the system and benefits derivable out of the system. So, economic feasibility says that is equal when. So, for any system, if the expected benefits equal or exceed the expected cost, the system can be judged to be economically feasible. And this economic feasibility, one benefit analysis is done in which expected cost and the benefits are evaluated. And economic analysis is used for evaluating the effectiveness of the proposed system. In such type of feasibility, the most important is the cost benefit analysis. And as its name suggests, that it is the analysis of the cost to be incurred in the system and the benefits derivable out of the system. So after economic feasibility, operational feasibility come, that actually can we execute or can we operate on the requirements which we gather from the user. Operational feasibility is mainly concerned with the issues like whether the system will be used if it is developed and the implemented, whether there will be resistance from the users that will affect the possible application benefits. The essential question that will help in testing the operational feasibility of a system are the does management support the project, and are the users not happy with the current business practices? Will it reduce the time operational considerably? If yes, then they will welcome the change and the new system. And will the proposed system really benefit the organization? Does the overall response increase? And will accessibility of the information be lost? Will the system affect the customers in the considerable way? So all these questions are considered into mind while doing operational feasibility. Legal feasibility says that the study concerned with the contracts, liability, violation, and legal and other traps frequently unknown to the technical staff, and all the related questions with this particular liability, violation, copyright, patent and all, that is checked under the legal feasibility. So students, this was all about your unit 1 last topics, ER data models. We have seen every aspect that should be studied while reading the or while making the ER models, ER data models. So this was all about for this video. Thank you so much.